Goldman Sachs, they've been caught out, and the Americans are charging them with fraud. Goldman Sachs invented a bond to sell to people, which was based on subprime mortgages. So it was a pretty hopeless thing to sell to people. But they designed it to lose money, because one of their other clients was a big hedge fund manager who were betting on the bond to lose. So Goldman Sachs were selling this bond to you, saying this is terrific, behind the back going to one of their clients, bet on this is complete rubbish. So Goldman Sachs basically proved that the entire financial collapse wasn't just an act of God or an accident, it was a fraud.
Can I just interrupt at this point?
Yeah.
Because I should make it plain, the law being as it is.
Yes.
Goldman calls the charges completely unfounded in law and fact.
What does Sachs say?
Yes. He completely agrees.
What can you do? You get caught, you get caught.
Frankly, I can't see any of this making it into the finished programme.
Are you worried about libel?
Yes. Unlike you, I haven't ever been done for it before.
I think there's very little chance of you getting any more than 2 years.
Yeah. And anyway, Jeremy, backstage, you were saying what a bunch of crooks Goldman Sachs.
Yeah.
You could present your programme from your cell. The mission could be to walk from one end to the other in the shortest possible time.
Anonymous hackers. Are they anonymous? I don't know where they're from.
No, we do know where they're from.
Where are they from?
They are from North Korea, it turns out.
Has that been proven?
Not totally proven. But they're not going to sue me, so I think... No, I think it probably is North Korea. There's something in there. Something in the code, when it was unhacked,
yes,
indicated that it might have been from North Korea.
Giles, you know way too much about this.
Only because I did chair the Cybersecurity Awards quite recently. I can't tell you where or when.
Is that security or Alzheimer's?
You know what the virus was called? It was called WannaCry. It demands money before you can get your computer files back.
Oh, yeah, it was all in Britcoins as well.
Bitcoins.
No, we've left the European market. They're Britcoins.
There's been a sort of failure of the government here, hasn't there?
They were warned, I mean, at least 3 years ago, that XP needed updating. But the trouble with the NHS, it spent a lot of money on IT already, about £12 billion, for a system that didn't work. So, essentially, it doesn't have any money left, so they didn't pay for the update.
We've not upgraded the security properly, and we've been running the NHS on Windows XP, so people have probably been told that they're dying by a helpful paperclip.
I like the idea that as a hacker, you would target for a ransom the NHS.
Yeah.
One of the few world organisations you know doesn't have any money.
Probably given Jeremy Hunt some ideas about how to get money out of it. What must it be like being Jeremy Hunt at the moment? Okay. Imagine he goes into hospital. He'll be the first person to have a sprained wrist treated anally. Sorry, Mr. Hunt, this is going to involve a bit of a run-up. Luckily, our computers are down, so there's no record of what's about to happen to you.
This bit of malware was actually stolen from the American National Security Association, you know, which is a misnomer.
Well, I think President Trump gave it away.
Does anyone know what the Russians have said about it? Exactly that.
Well, they're claiming it's not them, because the Russian Interior Ministry was targeted.
That was a decoy.
You're so clever, Giles.
These are just things I picked up at the cybersecurity conference.
The Russians have said this completely doesn't concern Russia.
Richard, here's another for you.
Oh, yes, of course, it's the flag of the European Union. We know that. Nigel Farage, and he's on his way to a public ceremony. Gays are allowed to get married for the since Sunday. It's fantastic. Really good news, brilliant. And this couple here are once the first to actually, you know, say the rights, and now a husband and husband. Fantastic news.
Oh, it's lovely.
It's a lovely story.
A lot of people think it won't last, but I'm all for it.
I think so. They've had a couple of arguments, a couple of them in public, but, you know, they'll get together as a couple, they'll be absolutely fine.
I think it's the story about Nick Clegg and Nigel Farage having a TV debate.
And who do you think won?
I don't think either of them are truly winners, are they? I think you've got best loser.
According to Donald McIntyre in The Independent, journalists had been briefed that Nick Clegg was going to do something unusual during the debate. What was it?
He was going to show some passion.
Get emotional.
On a space hopper.
And did he get emotional?
He got a bit emotional.
He used his hands a lot, didn't he? Sort of, you know, just to show emotion and stuff. And he took his shirt off as well, I think, didn't he?
As far as I understand it. They wrestled like men. I quite enjoyed the debate, I think because of the way I watched it, because I didn't watch the pictures, I just had the audio. Then I turned the volume right down, and genuinely I enjoyed it.
Well, it's slightly odd. You're the Deputy Prime Minister, and you're taking on live television, a man who hasn't got one MP. And he wins. Mm. You know, this is supposed to be equal status.
Apparently, Clegg told Farage, "You're making things up to make a point," to which Farage replied, "You've done pretty well out of it."
In other mistake news, why have Google been suffering from rogue anuses?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. This is... There's a computer program which misreads old print, so arms comes out as anus, so farewell to anus. I drape my anus across her shoulder in a comforting manner. This is what's happening. This is what's happening. They tell us if I'm making it up, but I'm not, am I, David?
You're not making it up. No. The scanning technology they use to turn books into e-books can't differentiate between arms and anus in certain typefaces.
Yeah.
Here's a quote from John McKay Wilson's Tales of the Borders. Poor Janet shuddered at the words which she heard him utter, for with strange and wicked oaths he vowed vengeance on the individual who'd persecuted him, and she flung her anus around his neck and kissed his forehead. From Georgina Bragg's Matisse on the Loose, she grabbed my anus and positioned my body in the direction of the East Gallery and we started walking. And in the complete works of Washington Irving, there is a reference to the great captain who had been one of his comrades in anus. Are there any other words that Google Books scanning technology is confused?
Yeah, it can't do tax.
Yeah, it reads tax as free. No, it's burn and bum get muddled up as well, as in a patent for a carrier for an integrated circuit that talks of bum in electrical contacts.
God, Scotland, what happens? It's bums night.
Where they all join anuses and sing old lang. They're not New Labour anymore. No. I hadn't noticed that. They're going to rebrand.
Yeah, Labour.
Labour Classic.
Yeah. They couldn't call themselves New Labour when Blair left. It's like when Mike Nolan left Bucks Fizz. They couldn't call themselves Bucks Fizz anymore.
Yeah. Labour could go with Bucks Fizz. Champagne socialists, but slightly diluted with orange juice. And the Lib Dems, what are they?
I think they're going to sit this election out. Yeah. It's probably...
They've got a note from their mother. Yeah.
I think they'll play the sympathy vote to a certain extent. Just have Nick Clegg topless holding a puppy and just looking into the camera like that. Mm. I don't...
According to the Sunday Times, what has David Cameron decided to do?
Resign.
No.
Go on holiday.
No, this is about the TV debates.
He's going to debate with Nigel Farage. He's going for the toughest one first.
That's right. Cameron is going to take on Farage. According to the Sunday Times, Cameron wants the TV debates to be in a 2-3-5 formation. So that's Cameron Miliband, Clegg Miliband Cameron, and Farage Cameron Clegg Miliband with Yaya Touré behind the strikers. Thank you for laughing. I don't know what that meant.
Basically, Ryan Giggs has spent an awful lot of money to ensure that he's become world famous for stuff other than football. Yeah. But people still might be sued for telling people that it was him. So.
Yeah, well, that's right. The MP, John Hemming,
yeah,
he said that apparently 75,000 people named Ryan Giggs on Twitter. It's not possible to arrest them all. Well, I mean, it's worth a go, though, isn't it? Yeah. Well, the thing is, the injunction is still in place.
That's right.
Yeah, that's the thing. Absolutely. Despite the people keep going blabbing it out, there's a legal expert, Joshua Rosenberg.
Yeah.
This is what he had to say about it, right?
Well, the law is clear. There is still a court order in force which says that we can't name Ryan Giggs as the person who brought these proceedings.
Stop!
I'm pleased we can say his name, though, because I was getting so fed up. Every newspaper, every day, it was like, Imogen Thomas has been having sexual liaisons with a man who cannot be named. It's like, what, Voldemort?
Yeah.
I sort of see why he did it as well, Ryan Giggs. Because you get the superintendent, he knows that if his identity was known, then people would know not only who he was, but also that his marriage was on the rocks. And at that point, John Terry would be round his house... like a sex-crazed whipper.
Yes, the worst-kept secret in Britain is finally out. Lawyers are a complete waste of money. As the row unfolded, thousands of Twitter users named Ryan Giggs in what the Daily Mail called one of the biggest acts of civil disobedience in modern times. Top that, Syria, lightweights.
Did News International senior executive James Murdoch boast about the way the company was handling the scandal only a week ago?
Well, he said that they've contained the scandal and it's now in a box.
Yeah. Yes, he said, we were really able to put this problem in a box. In a box marked fuck up.
He called him a mafia don.
Yeah.
Which isn't nice, is it?
Well, they were very upset about it, and they sent me a letter of complaint.
Really?
Pinned to a horse's head.
What happens to the rest of the horse? I mean, doesn't anyone ever get a horse's arse?
I suppose it must be for more minor misdemeanors, you know.
Well, a horse's arse, I think, would be worse than a horse's head. Waking up next to a horse's arse.
It's like...
I think there's something personal about that.
You might say that a horse's arse was more flirtatious, though.
Flirtatious.
That's
flirtatious.
A good word to pick. Mm.
That's an interesting window into your life. Yeah.
What, according to The Observer, did Rupert Murdoch do when Gordon Brown became PM and initiated an investigation into the phone hacking?
He phoned up number 10.
Asked the Gweezy.
Yeah.
Their source was an ex-minister who wants to remain anonymous.
Do you think, though, that Murdoch could just ring up number 10 during your time there?
I know nothing.
You know nothing? Is that why you were in the cabinet?
So what did you think of him then?
What, Gordon?
Yeah, he was all right, wasn't he?
He was the Prime Minister.
Yeah. Then you can't have a more ringing endorsement than that.
The news of the world may be dead, but its wretched ghost continues to haunt. The news of the world paid a private investigator to carry out surveillance on the hacking victim's lawyer, Mark Lewis, which involved following the ex-wife of Mr. Lewis and his teenage daughter as they visited a branch of Tesco. Well, if you're looking to intimidate someone, every little helps.
Oh, yes, this is the happy news of the mine has been released, although apparently viewers are getting rather fed up with the coverage because it's all rather similar. So the last 15 miners are going to be part of a lottery game where they're going to be holding up a number. And you, if you've got the number at home, it's your chance to win... Oh, what was that?
Somebody winning the lottery.
Oh, somebody winning the lottery.
Do you know what the sequence of events was for each rescued miner?
They got in the thing, and they took them out.
Yeah.
They got out of the thing.
Pretty much. According to the Times, the claustrophobic escape capsule takes 15 minutes to travel 700 metres. If you want to imagine what that's like, take a trip on the Northern Line. The 24-hour news channels have been enjoying this story, but there was just a hint that they might be running out of things to say. Let's have a look.
So far, the only miner to emerge from the tube with a beard.
Next, Peter Adams analyses Reginald's what?
It's got to be bonsai, isn't it?
Oak.
He analyses Peter Adams analyses Reginald's tree and finds it isn't bonsai. It's just very far away.
it was bonsai. It was Peter Adams analyses Reginald's bonsai. Here's Peter Adams in bonsai focus. It's his actual size, obviously. Several celebrities own bonsai trees, such as Ronnie Corbett. He likes a bit of shade.
Does Tom Cruise have a bonsai as well?
Hey, don't slag Tom off, all right?
It was just a normal-sized tree.
Leave him alone. Leave him alone. He suffered enough.
Did you go and see him because you're going to have a remake of Twins, the Danny DeVito and Arnold Schwarzenegger film?
You should remake all of Arnie's films, actually. Be
you have been well and truly rumbled.
The
there,
Terminator.
Yeah.
I'll be back. I'm telling you that. I will be back. I'll bloody be back. I'll tell you. I'll tell you that. I'll be back.
Be commando facing all those people. Oh, watch it, lads. Someone's going to get hurt.
Is there any other impressions you do other than me?
I do Tony Blair, but then I sound like him anyway.
Offend someone in Tony Blair's voice.
You know.
That's it. I'm offended.
And so, to round two, the strengthometer of news. Fingers on buzzers, teams. Here's the first one.
That's a cake, isn't it? It's the Great British Bake Off winner, that is. Oh, so, yes. There was talk about there being some misogyny. Some people on the internet were very harsh about some of the contestants, I believe.
Go on, what is it now?
We were just going to tell you who the people were. The gentleman on the left is Monsieur Raymond Blanc, the television chef, and he tweeted what appeared to be a sarcastic remark about the winner 24 hours before the winner was announced.
Oh.
And possibly spoilt the whole competition.
But he got it wrong, because it wasn't the winner.
Indeed, he said, you know, French is my second language. Theresa May then phoned up and said, oh, you're... You're some froggy, Waller, are you? Well, get out! Get out!
This is what he tweeted. The Great British...
It's now time for the odd one out round. Just one between you this week. Mm. Ming the Mollusk, Glenn Greenwald's phone, Bert Kwok, and the E. coli 0157.
Well, I think it's called Ming the Mollusk because it's 500 years old and dates back to the Ming dynasty. And scientists found it, didn't know how old it was, killed it.
Killed it.
Yeah.
And then discovered it was the oldest animal that they think has ever lived.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So you can get ill from eating those.
Yeah.
E. coli can make you ill.
Absolutely. Bert Kwok, is it the actor or is it the part he's playing there in the Pink Panther films? It's Kato. It's the actor.
It's the part.
It's the part. Kato. Give us a clue.
Yeah.
Containing the answer. Oh, cold.
Cold.
Oh, right, OK. Yes, Kato was hidden in a fridge.
Yes.
He was hiding in the fridge in one of the films, shot in the dark, I think, and he comes, bang. So it's about people being put in fridges. The mollusk was put in a, should have been put in a fridge and it would have survived. Kato jumped out of a fridge, he was all right. The E. coli bacteria is all right if you freeze it. And it's the bloke with the phone.
His phone was hidden.
The fridge thing was right. Everything else was wrong. Yeah, but I'm still going to give you a point because I feel like we should move on.
No, but the other one out, what, it was Glenn Greenwald's phone.
No, it wasn't. Right. Stop taking over. You can do that on your radio show, which is on at 3:30.
You've got a radio show? Yeah, Monday's
2 p.m. I'm going to write that down.
The odd one out is Ming the Mollusk.
Ming the Mollusk.
All the others have survived a stint in the freezer, except for Ming the Mollusk, who died.
Okay.
Glenn Greenwald,
yes.
The former Guardian journalist who was involved in the publication of the intelligence emails leaked by Edward Snowden, regularly used to put his phone in the freezer. Why would he do that?
He was worried it would be bugged.
Or security, yes. There's an even more effective place you can put your phone to stop anyone hacking it. Any ideas?
Is that News International HQ?
A martini shaker.
Oh, OK.
E. coli 0157, one of the nastiest strains of E. coli, can survive in the fridge or the freezer. How old were you when you first got colonised by an E. coli bacterium, Janet?
Funnily enough, I had amoebic dysentery when I was 7. And I was actually in hot 5 days.
How on earth did you get that? I thought I was...
I got it in Fulham. I grew up quite near you, Paul.
Yes.
I think it's something you sent from Fulham Palace Road to my road.
I used to send out those parcels all the time.
Ming the Mollusk was an ocean quahog, a type of clam. How easy is it to date a clam?
Well, you have to get them drunk first. There's an app called Chowder.
Yeah.
You need to watch out for chlamydia, though. It's quite... No, I've never dated a clam before.
No. Mm-hmm.
Pulled a few muscles. but if nothing else, this story brought out a certain solidarity amongst headline writers. What do you think the Independent, the Mirror and the Mail all went with for their headline?
Clam dead after 500 years. No. That wouldn't be very good, would it? Shuts.
Clam shut. Clam shell, clam shut, clam...
Tears. Cry.
Yes. Clam claps mime artist.
No! No. Are you digging the piss? You know what it is now.
No.
You do!
This is what stupid people look like!
No. I've never seen anyone worse at charades than you.
No.
That is a very good clam mime.
We've got the clam
bit. Oh, sorry. The sad bit, the sorrow. What would happen? Oh, damn, it's such a...
A shame.
Crocodile.
What a shame!
Clarity!
Terrible. No, it's terrible. It's a comedy.
I'm not mad,
am I? You all got that.
What were the tears for? How would that lead us to calamity as a
that
pun?
That was useless.
Right, you're going. You can be the panelist now. Come on.
This is the most powerful number, 7. Is that right? They did a survey. I must have read this somewhere.
They have. They've done a survey, and 7 is the world's favourite number.
Ah, favourite number.
Yes. Alex Belos asked 44,000 people to submit their favourite number, and 7 proved the most popular. Mm. He describes it as the loner, the outsider, the Nigel Farage of the number one. Shall we go through the top 10 world's favourite numbers?
Yes.
Yeah.
What's at number one?
Number 10, sorry.
So, number 10, what do you think?
Number 9 is number 10.
Nope.
Number 8 is number 10.
No.
Number 10 is number 10.
No.
Number 1.
No.
2.
No, all numbers are available.
Oh, 128.
No, at number 10, the 10th most popular number is, in fact, 11. At 9.
It's 10.
No.
40.
No.
21.
No.
100.
At number 9 is the number 2.
2.
The most popular number in 8th position is 6. At 7, the 7th most popular number is 9, and the 6th most popular number is 13. OK, here's the top 5.
This is going to be on Channel 4 for a whole evening. There'll be some talking heads in a minute. What do you think of 6? Yeah, love it.
I've always liked 5 because it's a working class number. That's what I like about 5.
Well, I think that 3, for me, I mean, when I was first growing up, I thought 3 was a magnificent... Oh, sorry.
I've started auditioning. Sorry. Where am I?
But let's firstly complete the top 5. Yeah. Number 5 is 5.
Yep, brilliant.
And number 4 is 4.
Yes.
And number 3 is 8.
Oh.
At number 2...
1.
Is 3.
3.
The magic number, and of course 7 is the top one, number 1. But the study did ask people to describe the numbers between 1 and 10. 2 was thought to be cautious, wise, fragile and sympathetic. How do you think 3 was described?
Nostalgic, sexy, unreliable.
3 is pretentious.
God.
4, according to the people who responded to the survey, is laid back and a rogue. Yeah, this is absolute bollocks, isn't it?
Nigel Farage.
Farage.
According to the Daily Telegraph, in musical terms, a song is an unlikely combination of choral and rap, known as crap.
I think I'd rather like that. What? Zadok.
That was really good.
You'll never guess what I just imagined. I imagined that was empty.
The best reaction I've ever got out of Paul.
You've never said before. Oh, well, that's guaranteed that to be in, otherwise you won't explain this to anybody.
Oh, dear.
Fingers on buzzers, teams, for the next one.
Have they shut the Humber Bridge to stop people going to Hull?
To stop people going to Hull?
Yeah.
They don't want any more tourists. They've got enough.
Maybe they're trying a new slogan, Hull, one letter different from hell.
Could be it, couldn't it?
Well, you're in the right neighbour. Both of you are in the right neighbourhood.
John Prescott's from Hull, always MP for Hull.
Yeah.
That's why they just close Hull.
Yes. He's not an MP anymore, is he? Other than being a... Yeah, no, he's
member of the House of Lords.
Oh, right. He's a Lord in Hull as well.
Mm-mm. Is he the Lord of Hull?
Well, I don't know. I am the Lord of Hull.
It is to do with Hull, but it's actually The Economist magazine. They have a very specific view on Hull.
Mm. It should be shut down. Is that what they...
Absolutely right, yes. The Economist magazine thinks that the city should be closed down along with Burnley, Middlesbrough and Hartlepool.
Closed down?
It's closed down.
Why?
The Economist described any efforts to save struggling northern communities as misguided. You lived in Leeds, didn't you?
Yeah, I was born in Leeds.
You were born in Leeds?
Yeah.
Should they close that down?
Leeds is doing very well. It's thriving.
Have you heard of Leeds, Ian?
Yes.
Yeah?
There's a football team in Leeds, isn't there?
There is. Leeds United. Yes.
You see? Local knowledge.
Paul, any view on Leeds?
So good they named it once.
Yes, this is The Economist magazine's plan to shut Hull. Grim, dull and uninspiring. The Economist comes out every week.
Paul and John, here's another for you.
Oh, cricket, obviously, black and white. The Pope. What's that? The Holy Beach Ball of Lords. What's that? Nuns. At least one of them's a man, I can see from here. The Vatican's got its own cricket team.
It has. Do you know what they're called?
The Angels. The Saints. The Pope's cricket team. The Vatican 11.
They're called the St. Peter's Cricket Club. And if you ask for an LBW decision, they'll deny you three times, apparently. Yes, get those references in. Yes, sorry, Giles. What does the Pope think of it?
Yeah, they have six-day matches, but never seven.
The Pope is really into football.
He is indeed, as we can see here in this photo. Oh, bollocks, it's not coming. Let's move on.
Yeah.
Sorry. I'm being quite unprofessional tonight. It's hormones, everyone. Right. It's not really. I haven't got any hormones in my body anymore, thank God. My husband's pleased. I haven't assaulted him for months. Do you know what Father Theodore Mascarenhas, the Vatican Cricket Club president, had to say? By the way, to give you a clue, he's an Indian spin bowler and he moves the ball in a mysterious way.
Sorry.
Well, he said, we hope that one day we will be able to translate silly mid-off into Latin. Want to have a crack at that, Giles?
My Latin is terrible. For years, I thought in loco parentis meant my dad's an engine driver.
Julius Caesar used to tell that one.
Marcus?
So it's a woman being inflated on the beach.
That's the girl who was accused of being a Russian spy because she went out with a politician. They found she wasn't a Russian spy, she was just a Russian.
Mm. Yep, you're quite right.
They thought she was a spy. She used to go into the House of Commons canteen and say, these sausages are rather cold for this time of year. the seagull flies high above Krakow. It sounded like secret messages.
I think they actually thought she was a spy because she made a beeline for a member of the Liberal Democratic Party.
So not very well informed, then?
No. They thought, what other reason could there possibly be?
She's phoning the Kremlin going, they are going to make corduroy compulsory.
Indeed, this is Katia Zyutilyeva, who had...
Oh, you bet you've practised that, haven't you?
Конечно.
Yeah, it was very good.
That's all my Russian.
That's very good. You just learned her name and that was it?
No, конечно. I just said, of course.
Bless you. I was of course as well. Blimey.
Здравствуйте. Меня зовут Кирсти. Как тебя зовут?
Oh!
Very good. Very good.
Hold on a minute. I just want to ring MI5.
Yeah, exactly. You're filling for the oldest trick in the book. We invited you onto this show. This show's not going out this week. These are cardboard figures. That's not Giles Brandy. That's a puppet. Oh. For the Muppet Show.
It was.
Now for the missing words round, which this week features as its guest publication Reg Transfers, the magazine for the world of personal number plates. And we start with Simon Cowell reveals what?
Reveals his number plate.
You probably can't see Simon Cowell's number plate for all the cigarette smoke billowing around his pregnant girlfriend. Did you see it? There were pictures of... Did you not see that?
People smoking.
There's a picture of him in a car, fagging away, pregnant girlfriend in the passenger seat.
Unbelievable. Lovely. I thought he was evil before, but...
Simon Cowell reveals his baby name choice is Simon.
Oh.
The baby's due in February. Simon Cowell's already got a high chair, some tiny clothes and a booster seat. All he needs now is to get some stuff for the baby. Next, Cornelius Gurlitt has been hiding what?
Is it complete as it is? Just been hiding.
That's the Nazi art.
Masterpieces, yeah.
I will give you that. Cornelius Gurlitt has been hiding secret Nazi art stash.
Yeah.
All the paintings were confiscated in the early 1940s, or as art historians call it, Hitler's angry period. Next, in Essex, we all have what?
Automatic weapons. an intrinsic knowledge of our local area. Personalised number plates.
One. Personalised plates. Yeah. There we are, yes. In Essex, we all have personal plates. I wanted my initials on my car, but I didn't fancy splashing out in a personalised number plate, so I just bought a second-hand AA van. Brilliant. Next. Police dogs will receive what?
I know this.
Go on, then.
Pensions. They're going to get pensions.
Pensions?
Absolutely right.
And rightly so.
Yeah.
Rightly so.
Yeah.
I can't believe nobody said truncheon meat.
Now, they did. That response is the reason why nobody did.
Next, George W. Bush planning what?
A gallery, an exhibition. Yeah. He's going to open an exhibition.
Yeah, but that's almost there, yes. He's planning to paint a series of... He's planning to paint a... Oh, Lord.
George W. Bush planning to paint a portrait series of world leaders.
God, we used to accuse him of not being able to read.
Yeah. According to The Telegraph, he is also known to dabble in landscapes, as the people of Iraq know only too well. And finally, David Suchet admits to what when playing Poirot?
Oh, I know that one.
Yeah. What is it?
Yes, he's got a penny up his ass, hasn't he? So it helps him mince the walk.
Oh, absolutely right, yep. David Suchet admits to clenching a penny between his buttocks when playing Poirot.
Which he learned from Laurence Olivier.
Yeah.
Who I think had more than pennies up his ass at one stage.
Right down to the line, Godfrey.
Sorry. I know you won't ask me back.
So, the
final... The Telegraph, thousands of people lining the streets have given the relay a carnival feel. For example, someone dressed as a cod and another as a chip in Falmouth. You Brits really know how to put on a show.
You wait till you see our opening ceremony. Yeah.
There'll be hundreds of chips. Six or seven cod. Morris in a giant cod costume.
This is the Olympic torch, which is boldly going where no Olympic torch has gone before. Namely, yes, I agree with you. Namely, Truro and Il Fracum.
Sounds deeply sexual. Kind of like a cigar advert. Have you been to Il Fracum?
I have.
The place is laced with prostitution.
It's a window. That's their new slogan now.
That's right. Come and get laid in Il Fracum.
Ian and Max, here's another for you.
Oh, good.
It's a train?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's a proper train. That's the two Eds. It's better than one. but not in this case.
It's about investment and infrastructure, yes. Well, you know, they're building this enormous boondoggle up north, Ian, and they're...
Is that a technical term?
Yes, boondoggle. It's economics is called big frickin' waste of money. And, you know, if you really want to connect the country and get the economy going, give everyone free access to broadband.
Yeah, I think I'd prefer to take the train.
You can't get to Birmingham fast enough. You can't in your virtual self. Impossible.
Yeah, so this is the wise investment slash catastrophic waste of billions of taxpayers' money.
Because the Labour Party have decided now, it was their idea originally to do it, but now that the Tories want to do it, they don't want to do it anymore.
And did you hear the actual words of the dire warning from the government about the consequences if Labour do not? And
no, I'd like to hear you say it.
The precise words were, years and years of gridlock, weekend cancellations, hellish journeys and replacement bus services. It's just hard to imagine what that would be like, isn't it? Do you know this week's figure of how much it's going to cost?
I think it's 130 zillion.
The government's current budget is 50 billion, although one independent study says it's going to cost 80 billion.
But you've got Mark Carney now as the Bank of England. He can just print it. Just print 80 billion. Just print it. That's fine. That's what he does. That's what he's there for. Print more money. Doesn't matter if it's 100 billion, 200 billion. Just print.
No downside to that?
Well, unless you include inflation. As long as you don't mind paying extra for energy and food, it's okay. Just keep printing money.
Okay, let's have the train.
Bail out the banks. Bail out. Just print money, it's fine. You put the money in the train and take it to Birmingham.
Listen, Max, 1 hour, 20 minutes to Birmingham. It's too long. More like an hour. Too long. I got stuff to do in Birmingham.
Very busy.
I got concrete to pour.
Yeah.
Doesn't pour itself, you know.
It doesn't.
Pour itself.
I don't care how many billions it costs. That shaves 20 minutes off of me getting to Birmingham and pouring concrete.
Time now for the odd one out round. It's just one between you this week. A dog in Thailand. Scott Mann, MP, Judith Strang from Texas, and Damien Green. Yes.
Now, Scott Mann, colleague of Johnny's.
Yeah.
And I believe there was an incident where Johnny actually saved his life. From drowning. So I'm guessing that he is perhaps the odd one out in that the other three all float.
Is that right? Did you save his life?
Yeah, I mean, it's just because I thought he had my wallet, actually.
He got sacked from the Tory party, or did he resign?
Damien Green's still an MP. He was Deputy Prime Minister and then had a slight...
There was some porn found on a computer that he had access to, and the other three people featured in the film he was watching.
They've all been rescued at sea, apart from Damien Green, who had to be rescued from a river. He was thrown in as part of a student prank while studying at Oxford University. But more recently, who did Damien Green have a run-in with outside Parliament?
Yeah, so there's a set of protesters that are, like, permanently outside Parliament, so that when anyone goes on TV, they just heckle with quite amusing abuse, to be honest, some of it. But obviously some of it's not. And Damien Green came off an interview and met this chap who's dressed in a European flag and told him that in a contested field, you are by far the biggest here. No. And he was right.
Let's have a look.
Hello, can I ask how you're feeling about the vote yesterday?
No, you can't, because you've just tried to shout over an interview I've done, like you do everyone else.
I did, I was singing.
You are the biggest wanker.
Where did this dog end up at sea?
Australia.
Hawaii. Same 5G company we're talking about.
Not quite. It was spotted last week by oil rig workers in Thailand, 135 miles from shore.
Wow. Oh.
Who threw that stick?
Wow.
And finally, where did Judith Strang from Texas end up in the sea?
On holiday, was it? On holiday somewhere?
Yes, she was on a tour of...
the fjords.
She was in Iceland. She sat down on some ice which had formed in the shape of a throne and was promptly carried out to sea.
How hot is her arse?
The iceberg incident happened a couple of weeks ago, after which the accident-prone granny completed her tour of Europe with a trip to Paris, where she lit a candle in Notre Dame.
Now, that really is enough about the government's bad week. Oh, no, sorry. Andy Coulson. Where did he unexpectedly find himself this week?
In the back of a cop car heading to Scotland.
Mm. Mm. Because?
Because they want to have a word.
Mm.
I had absolutely no idea that you were a gangster.
Andy Coulson.
He's been arrested for perjury.
Yes.
During a trial where someone else was on trial for perjury.
Yes.
While he was actually working for the Prime Minister, which is pretty shocking. You shocked, Alistair?
I'm shocked.
You. I'm glad you're shocked, because, you know, some of the people that this government have been hanging about with, Rebecca Brooks, know her at all?
I do.
Were you shocked when she was arrested?
I've been shocked by lots of things, Ian.
He's been charged, though, not just arrested. Yeah. He's been charged.
He's been charged.
Which is why Ian's being so careful.
Yeah.
About have we got Andy Coulson, if not about me.
Well, you haven't charged you yet.
is it hot in here?
In case anyone thinks I'm being gratuitous, I know that Alistair is going to be reasonable tonight because he told Leveson, I am robust, but I'm not a bully. So no matter what anyone says, you're going to be really reasonable.
Tonight? No.
That's good, though, to remember. Like, if your kid gets caught, like, kicking a fat kid, just go, no, he's not a bully, just robust. He's robust.
It probably seemed like a good idea when you said yes.
In a bit to make sure this never happens again, of course, Lord Strathclyde has announced he's going to do a rapid review into curbing the House of Lords powers. I'll give you a bonus point if any of you can give me the real name of Lord Strathclyde.
Bunty.
Is it one of those bonkers long names?
Yes, he's called Thomas Galloway Dunlop Durois de Bleakey Galbraith.
Nah.
Another man of the people.
Well, he's also got product placement in the middle of his name.
Yes.
Poor Nick. He just can't trust the Tories.
Does he change his name in wet weather?
Several of the papers identified one clear supervillain in all this. Who was that?
Well, apart from the obvious one.
Who's the obvious one?
Andrew Lloyd Webber.
Yes. Mega-rich musical gargoyle, Andrew Lloyd Webber.
Musical gargoyle.
He flew in from New York to vote for tax credit cuts. It was his first vote in over 2 years. He's previously voted just 30 times out of a possible 1,898 in 14 years. But he did deny he had flown back specifically for the vote. Does anyone know why he says he was in town?
He was here for an opening of one of his productions somewhere.
A new musical called Cuts.
Yes, he did say he was in town to watch the revival of Cats, the musical. Yeah. But surely he's seen that already. Or maybe he's just got a bad memory. News this week, with talk of lockdown easing, some people are back in training for the morning commute.
You can tell that footage is fake. There's someone reading The Economist.
It's likely there'll be some government advice about the wearing of face masks. Would you like to see how the Belgian Minister for Face Masks got on when he visited a face mask factory?
Absolutely.
Let's have a look. Let's have a look at this incredibly awkward moment.
En dan is het kwestie van je mondmasker nog aan te doen.
Chris, I'm sorry you didn't see that, but trust me, you could teach him a thing or two about how to put a face mask on.
For the people at home, by the way, what, like, I've had a lot of these videos just before we filmed. I had them described to me, so I've already done me laughing. I'd also like to say as well, I'm very aware that I might not, because I can't see the camera, I've got this little earpiece in, my gaze might kind of drift. And if it makes anyone feel awkward at home, just move to your left a bit.
Typical BBC advice. Always trying to smuggle in the agenda. I can spot it.
David Cameron is kind of the main act. What did you make of his speech?
Well, I mean, again, he's quite competent. He doesn't mess up the autocue. He got some applause. He did some stuff in the middle. He quoted Kipling, the poet, not the cake maker.
Don't patronise me! To be fair, I always thought it was pronounced Kipling.
It's National Poetry Day today, isn't it?
Is it?
I think it is,
yeah. Yeah, it is.
Well, not tomorrow, obviously, when we're showing, so that ruins that. This isn't live! It's barely breathing.
How did you feel about him having a go at your friend Jeremy Corbyn, Diane?
Well, it's certainly not the kinder, gentler politics.
He did say in his speech of Jeremy Corbyn, he said, "My friends, we cannot let that man inflict his security-threatening, terrorist-sympathising, Britain-hating ideology on the country we love." This was in reference to an interview Corbyn gave in 2011 where he said it was a tragedy bin Laden had been assassinated rather than tried in an international court. BBC News didn't mention that nuance in their coverage of Cameron's speech because they've still got a licence fee to defend.
And so to round two, the strengthometer of news. Fingers on buzzers, teams. Here's the first one.
It's the London Marathon. There was a row with the Guinness Book of Records about whether this nurse should get a record for doing the shortest time dressed as a nurse. And Guinness said she doesn't look like a nurse, because I think the people at Guinness had perhaps been watching different videos of nurses than the training ones now on offer. And she rightly appealed this, and she now is the quickest nurse in the business. I mean, absolutely. This is your area, so, I mean, you must know.
Well, yes, yes, it is my area, kind of.
You help
obviously
your
not running. I did do a walk from Hull to Liverpool for support relief. Yeah, that was pretty amazing, because that was like 20 miles a day for a week. And they did tell me that I would burn 6,000 calories a day. Unfortunately, I ate 9,000 a day. This nurse is called Jessica Anderson, and yes, you were right, she was wearing trousers, OK? As you said, she was ineligible, because that's not...
She was wearing scrubs, wasn't
scrubs,
she?
That's right, yeah. According to Guinness, the guidelines said a proper nurse's uniform should include a pinafore and a cap. when did they write those rules? 1850s? Actually, the Daily Mail helpfully provided us with a photo of a marathon-running nurse that falls within Guinness guidelines. Here we are. What actually made them change their mind about her world record?
Which, didn't she appeal?
She did. She pointed out the inherent sexism, and they released a statement saying, "Our guidelines were outdated, incorrect, and reflected a stereotype we do not in any way wish to perpetuate." Even though they just did. Fingers on buzzers, teams. Am I meant to be doing this again? I've kind of...
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we've still got a bit more of this, haven't we? Thanks, Paul.
No, we like seeing it.
Oh, what? Do you?
Yeah.
That was completely out of sync.
Yeah, that was terrible. Hang on.
No. That was quite bad.
That was quite bad.
You'd have to do it all again.
This is a shambles.
Hang on. What's going on, Steve? We can't replace her now. What are you talking about? Too late.
Put the hammer down.
My husband often says that to me. OK. Fingers on buzzers, teams.
This is a story about someone who stole a piece of Stonehenge. Mm. And you just thought they would have noticed. I mean, look, there he is. wasn't very subtle about it. He kept it and he took it to America and he's finally returned it because after all these decades, he's got bored of a bit of stone.
His name's Robert Phillips. He stole it in the 1950s when a restoration team drilled metal supports into some of the stones to keep them in position. He's just turned 90. Kept it as a memento. Why is he returning it after 60 years?
Was he sick of cars slowing down in front of his house to have a look?
He was worried about what would happen to it after his death. The sarsen stone... Don't ask me what a sarsen stone is. It just says it's a type of...
It's one of the stones. Mm. They're different types. Mm. The standing ones and the sarsen ones.
Mm. The top ones.
What a dork.
You're not denying
that's,
it.
That's a completely different type of stone, which is down the perimeter.
Do you like Stonehenge?
I love Stonehenge. I used to go there when you could go up there and help in the building.
What? We start with the bigger election stories of the week. Ian and Romesh, take a look at this.
I'm trying to get out of the country. No, this is the race to get the first result in while people are still awake.
So women can't count? Just devastating. Ed Miliband looking chilled out.
They're shouting at him.
Oh, so relaxed. You're an immigrant? No.
This is the throne.
The legend.
Just this way. And it's the winner.
I hate you.
Oh, there's balance. These are all people who've gone. Liberals, Hughes, poor old Danny Alexander.
Have I won?
No. No, he stayed in as punishment. And then it's goodbye. It was quite exciting because everyone said it was unpredictable, meaning they got it wrong. So we had this exit poll when we came out, which more or less told you what the result would be, which is a Tory win, except they'd understated the win. And then everyone spent the rest of the evening going, well, if this poll's right, oh, God, it is right.
I'm just going to stay up to see if the exit polls rot. I know, I've stayed up for no reason.
They had Paddy Ashdown on the beginning of the evening saying, if that exit poll's right, I'm going to eat my hat. Typical Lib Dem, the end of the evening, they gave him a hat. Did he keep his promise?
You're absolutely right, Ian.
It was great... the election.
Yeah, it was.
It was the election.
Oh,
I think we've nailed that question. Now,
fingers on buzzers, teams. This is Jamie Oliver. He's got into trouble because he's come up for a recipe for paella, which the Spaniards don't agree is paella, and so he's got into trouble because of that.
Because he's added chorizo.
Chorizo.
Uh-oh, chorizo. Yeah. Bad. I don't know what that is.
Plus, some people don't find it very appetising because he's got a picture of his face right in the middle of it.
Some of the abuse was pretty bad, eh? They said, why don't you go and make chicken nuggets out of your own fingers?
Yeah, a Spanish man, Antonio Villarreal, tweeted, my version of fish and chips combines aubergine with duck. And one Daily Mail commenter added, Jamie, I voted for Brexit because you said you would leave the country if we won. Why are you still here? But why? Why are people so angry?
This is cultural appropriation, which, you know,
but
essentially...
I've had chorizo in paella in Spain. In lots of the... Like,
yeah,
lots
but
of times.
You are not allowed to say this is my recipe for paella because... You're not Spanish. Like, if you cook spaghetti bolognese, anyone who cooks it tonight is guilty of cultural appropriation. The only thing we are allowed to cook is fish fingers. That is Britain in Brexit future.
You should just have called it paella a la Gibraltar, and then... No, your wife is Spanish.
Yes. Next.
What would happen if you put a bit of chorizo in the paella?
Oh, well, there are very strict rules of what should and shouldn't go into a paella. And
finally, something Nick's expert on.
Can anyone tell me what Jamie has named his newborn son?
Is it food-related?
Yeah.
Basil.
Oh,
non-stick frying pan. George Foreman.
What's going to happen at Buckingham Palace at precisely 12:30 a.m?
Oh, they're turning the lights off.
They absolutely are.
And all the foreign crews are furious because their audiences will have just woken up. So when all the American broadcasters want to stand outside Buckingham Palace and say, here I am live, it's going to be completely dark. Selfish of us. Why couldn't we time the wedding to be in the middle of the night here? Then the Americans could watch. And I hope there are ad breaks so that NBC can shove in an advert for, what is it, nachos they have?
According to the Telegraph, Kate has invited her very first boyfriend, Willem Marks.
I like Williams that are too posh to bother with the E bit. They're all Willem. What's your name?
Is it Bill, Will, William, Willem? There's even a video wedding book for the public to sign. So let's have a look at some of the messages of goodwill and affection that have been left so far. Royal wedding will cost in one day half what the UK spends yearly on help for the unemployed.
Oh, lovely.
May their long and happy marriage be the last one of the monarchy of the UK. Vast numbers of people couldn't give the tiniest shit. Do I need to do this number six
you
one?
Do Helen Mirren.
Yes,
Helen
sorry.
Oh, that's right. Nice. We'd all like to do Helen Mirren, but we're going to do a bloody quiz show, mate. That's what we're doing here.
Helen Mirren played the Queen, of course.
Oh, right, yes, yeah.
And here she is talking about John Gielgud on BBC Breakfast News.
So that always inspired me. He always took kind of edgy choices.
Yes, and he swore a lot, as I remember.
And that, there was well, in that sort of wonderful voice he had.
Exactly. Yeah. No, that was
you
the
little
comedy.
Shit. Oh, oh, no, I can't
no.
say
that. Sorry. Take that.
But it was the original film.
If you heard that, we're very sorry.